Greetings, Guardians! Welcome back to Extra Lore, my name is Bife. So, a few things before we jump into this particular video, which is going to be talking about the lore of the Crucible. I thought that instead of getting my own gameplay for this one, which is okay, but not the best, I would, whilst I'm talking about Crucible Legends, show you the gameplay of some real-life Crucible Legends. The gameplay in the background is from three wonderful gentlemen, namely Blecious Plays, Enkooch, and Tommy Hush. So go ahead and subscribe to their channels. All of those are linked in the description. Also, a small plug for you guys. There's only 2 days left to get my 300,000 subscriber t-shirt. You can go ahead and pick that up from Teespring. And of course, I'm also selling hoodies of that. So if that interests you, go ahead and check those out. I do guarantee that they will come back if enough of you guys go ahead and pre-order one on the campaign after it's done too. So it's not completely impossible that these are gone forever. Just go ahead and make sure that you guys are still looking out for those, because we only have a few days left. Anyway, let's go ahead and talk about the topic of lore for this particular video, and that is going to be Lord Shaxx, the Crucible, and the Red Jacks. Now, first of all, the Crucible is one of the staples of Destiny, as you guys know. We've all had some experience of it, whether it's grinding through the Crucible story quest or getting into a sweaty scene properly. However, behind Destiny's PvP, there is some really awesome lore. So, given that it's got some relation to the Iron Banner and the new game mode that's going to be rolled out in Rise of Iron, I thought this would actually be a really good time to go ahead and touch on what we know of that. So first of all, how was the Crucible formed? When was it formed? Well, it was actually a creation of Lord Shaxx, and it happened in the wake of the Twilight Gap, the famous battle that saw many individuals from the city fall. Now, there was a lot of influential movement after this battle, because the Fallen Assault had been so devastating, and there were these movements to try and make the city stronger afterwards, so that if ever there was a second attack of such a similar scale, that they would be ready for it. And this leads to a whole bunch of different actions from different people, this sort of resurgence movement. It prompts the Crusades of Saint 14, where he literally goes out and kills the House of Devils until finally he headbutts their Kel, Sulkis, to death. It then prompts Faisal Crux to go ahead and take the armor of fallen guardians and craft them into a weapon that's worthy of their honor, in other words, the Yallahorn. However, Lord Shaxx is a wholly different side to this approach and this movement of resurgence. He realized that with so many guardians dead, a new generation had to take its place. They were all pretty untrained and fresh guardians, and they had legends to fill the shoes of. Anna Bray had vanished at the Twilight Gap, Saint 14 was lost, and the ranks of practically every guardian order of every kind probably would have been thinned out by this battle. So, with a horde of kinder guardians jumping in to fill the shoes of this generation of his, Shaxx decided that it was his duty to go ahead and train them and prepare them for the next onslaught. So he made a proposal to the Consensus. For those of you who don't know, the Consensus is kind of the governing body of the city. It's made up of the local factions that rule, as well as, of course, the Vanguard, and is overseen mainly by the Speaker. All proposals have to be sent for him to approve them. Now, Shaxx's proposal was a very simple one: to fund the creation and implementation of a Crucible, which would be a live-fire arena in which Guardians would face off against each other in order to train. It was kind of a perfect solution. Guardians would get to test their light against ferocious competition among their own ranks, and it would result in them becoming better Guardians and field operatives. However, they could afford to do live-fire exercises, because the Ghosts could be standing by to revive the Guardians in question. And so, the Crucible was born. But it became so much more than simply this training ground. It became gladiatorial, pageantry, almost. Crucible champions rose up the ranks and got far more out of the experience than mere training. It didn't take long until the entire city had taken notice. Matches started being broadcast to the citizens of the city, who took to gambling, spectating, and even supporting individuals who went into the Crucible. The most favored guardians among these weren't just training as a result. They actually became celebrities, much like some of the better Crucible players of today. The factions actually then started to take notice, and would give sponsorships to winners that won glory in their colours. City foundries would use this as an opportunity to show off their latest hardware and equipment in the Crucible as a public proving ground. And the Guardians? Well, they gained honour and glory. Small note about the city foundries, by the way. It's well worth keeping in mind that Tex Mechanica has used some similar tactics with this. However, they actually tried to go ahead and match fix things in the Crucible so that they could show off their Tex Mechanica wear as being superior, and Shaxx very quickly put an end to that. It never even happened in the first place. They were met with a rather stern-looking conversation with Arkite. and as a result, Shaxx has always had a little bit of a grudge for their gear. But anyway, back onto the point of honor and glory. On this, it's worth talking about the Crucible champions that aren't too well spoken of, but are definitely some of the more notable ones. I personally think the most important one of all is a guy called Thalor. Thalor is a Titan who believed that there was no greater glory than the glory one could obtain in the Crucible, and that Guardians could obtain no truer form of immortality than this. It's a pretty bold statement to make to anybody who has a ghost, and essentially makes most mortal wounds irrelevant as a result. But then again, Crucible players will kind of understand what Thalor means. The moments that are crafted are broadcast to the city. But all of this aside, there's also that moment, personally, where you can look back and you can remember the adrenaline of making a great play. The moment when you feel like you've perfectly executed an attack and left an opponent with nothing but the option of defeat. There is power in that rush, and Thalor, I think, understood that. Some Titans talk about a higher state of enlightenment that can be obtained within the depths of combat, where pure concentration is really achieved. Perhaps Thalor is one such Titan, as he's quoted to have said, "One day in the Crucible tells you everything you need to know about a Guardian, even yourself." Thalor was undoubtedly the greatest Crucible legend that we've seen, and he was seen as invincible until his encounter with one of the most incredible villains of Destiny and the Crucible itself, namely, Dredgen Yor. Before his time, the notorious Dredgen Yor was simply known as a Guardian called the Noble Man. His real name, of course, by this point is probably lost to us. But his time in the darkness saw a change so dramatic that he became one of the greatest abominations the city had ever borne witness to. From the moment of his corruption, the Noble Man would live a half-life. The other half of that life was Dredgen Yor. Yor used his skills in the Crucible to dominate other Guardians with the aid of his notorious hand cannon, Thorn. Even to this day, Thorn is one of the most recognizable Crucible weapons, and is also one of the most notorious. It was at one point the most used exotic primary in the Crucible, perhaps even the most used weapon, full stop, and it tended to dominate other Guardians with great ease. It's had multiple nerfs throughout the entire lifespan of Destiny, and still can pack a punch if you know what you're doing. So in a sense, it makes a little sense that Dredgen Yor was as feared as he was. He even managed to finally dethrone Thalor, defeating the Crucible champion once and for all. But his stay in the Crucible wouldn't be a long one in the end. He would end up killing the fabled hunter Pahainin in the Crucible, and this would reveal his darker secret. Guardians aren't supposed to be able to kill other Guardians. It takes an ability to drain one's light in order to do that in the Crucible, and Thorn, in its darker, unpurified form that we would wield, is capable of doing that. Pahainin, by the way, for those of you who are interested and maybe remember or recognize that name, is one of the three members of the fireteam that raided the Vault of Glass. Just something you guys can know on the side. After he had been killed, though, Dredgen Yor took the time after killing Pahainin to go into exile. This, of course, was not necessarily him as Dredgen Yor, maybe it was the Noble Man exerting some control to push himself away from other Guardians so that he might not be harmed. But even in the wilds, he would continue to stalk the prey that he found, whether it was strong or weak. It's also well worth noting that the three Vanguard members, on a totally separate note, Ikora Rey, Commander Zavala, and Cade Six, are all former Crucible champions. It's even something you can hear if you wander by Shaxx. Sometimes he'll be talking about how there was no light quite like Ikora's, or how Zavala should teach the new guard what it's really like to run in the Crucible, or how Cade used to run through the Crucible like a game. It's all very well talking about the champions of the Crucible, but there's actually a set of elite Guardians that also supports the ongoing activities of the Crucible. Now, you've probably heard of the Iron Banner and Trials of Osiris, as well as their respective organizers, such as Lord Saladin and Brother Vance. But did you know there's actually an entire legion of fireteams that Shaxx commands? These fireteams are collectively known as the Red Jacks, and their fireteams are responsible for some of the most incredible feats of the Crucible. Now, this isn't necessarily feats of actual fighting. They're responsible for securing and implementing new Crucible arenas. But think about some of the places that we go. They have taken over some of the most dangerous areas in the solar system. They've taken places such as Thieves' Den, which is a previous House of Winter base over on Venus. They've taken over, most notably of all, both the dungeons and the Cathedral of Dusk on the Dreadnought. Barely hours after we managed to claim the Dreadnought's initial capture zone and a transmount was set up, the Red Jacks were clearing areas out to be used as Crucible arenas. That's pretty incredible if you think about it, given that it's in the bowels of an enemy fortress, basically. makes you even more amazed when you think about the fact that they've cleared out the cauldron. But it does also make them highly notorious. The Red Jacks are the ones that scouted the Skyburner's firebase on Phobos, as well as Holburn, who is another legendary Titan who I'm sure we'll talk about later down the line in one of these lore episodes. And, of course, they're also responsible for partially clearing and setting up the tracks for SRL. And, of course, this means that they have some small relation to Amanda Holiday, but they do primarily answer to Lord Shaxx. So, I think that's most of the lore that I can go over this particular time around. There's other stuff on the Trials of Osiris and Iron Banner, but I actually don't want to go into that too deeply because I can go ahead and make their own videos on those. I've actually already made the Iron Banner one, so if you guys want to go ahead and check that out, that's also going to be linked somewhere at the end of the video. And one more time, guys, thank you so much to the wonderful Enkooch, Tommy Hush, and Blesious Plays for their great gameplay. And I need to remind you guys one more time, those t-shirts are only on sale for about another 2 days, so pick them up if you want one. You do not have a long time. But in the meantime, guys, thank you so much for watching. My name is Bife. Prodacia Arastra. I'll see you, Starside.